Let's discuss my professional church league baseball career for a minute. As the lone Jewish guy on a Christian team, it was never lost on me that part of my job may have been to die for my teammates' sins, which I never got around to because I was busy committing my own. Like the 30 or 40 fly balls I misplayed in right field, or the throw to second, which would have been spectacular except the runner was heading for third, or the population of a small, unincorporated town that I stranded on base while I created outdoor air conditioning by swinging the bat at nothing. You get the idea what's going on here. And yet I do it all again in a heartbeat because the game itself is poetry. And we will run with that today on Book of the Day. Book of the day, back to you. As I look outside here in Wisconsin, we are getting snow. We are absolutely getting snow, which I intend to send to my esteemed book critic, Steve Donahue, in a matter of 24 hours. Good day to you, sir.
Hello, everybody. Your short sleeve weather here.
Well, as we know, things are meant to change, and I suspect this is heading your way. So anyway, but today, it's that time of year when things, we get a little hankering for pastoral type things. What you got for us?
We have America's pastime. Yes, indeed. Which it turns out is not invidious armed insurrection. It turns out it's baseball. And we have a winner today. We have a classic, Casey at the Bat. The poem Casey at the Bat, which once upon a time, I don't know how many people know it today, but once upon a time, it was easily the most popular poem in American history.
Sure.
It was written by Ernest Thayer in 1888. So at the same time that the London News was filled with stories of Jack the Ripper, we were getting a beloved poem about a fraught baseball game in Mudville, where it doesn't look good for the Mudville Nine. It looks like they're going to lose. And they know the face and name of their salvation. If Casey could get to bat, all would be well. The mighty Casey would not fail, but unfortunately, the lineup doesn't favor him. Flynn is first, and then Blake. And Flynn is well known as a Lulu, and Blake is well known as a cake. It is assumed that they will let the team down, and that sheer propinquity of the order will stop Casey from getting back. But to everyone's astonishment, Flynn and Blake come through, and suddenly it's Casey's turn at bat. And he is so sure of himself he lets the first ball go by. It's a strike, but he just doesn't feel like it. It's not my style. And then he lets the second ball go by because he's not inclined to do that either. Any of these things can be a home run at any time. Casey, the whole game is at his feet. But after the second strike,
I have respect for a choosy batter. I like a batter who knows what they like.
A little too choosy. After the second strike, Casey becomes angry. He pounds the mat. He swings his bat with rage. He's not going to let the ball go by again. But he strikes out. Somewhere the band is playing. Somewhere the sun is bright. Somewhere our children are playing, but there is no joy in Mudville. Mighty Casey has struck out. I have one edition here. I don't know what edition that's had a million editions.
Numerous.
Right here.
Oh, beautiful.
With artwork beautiful by C.F. Payne that is just wonderful.
Wow. Oh, just great. Wow, look at that.
Apparently doffing his cap to
that's
the sand.
Great.
And there he is letting the ball go by. It's not his style.
That's great. But
when the umpire calls strike, the crowd is outraged. How could you call a strike on Casey? They say, from the benches black with people, there went up a muffled roar, like the beating of the storm waves on a stern and distant shore. Kill him! Kill the umpire! Shouted someone in the stand. And it's likely they'd have killed him. Had not Casey raised his hand.
Please.
Out of the rising tumult, he bids the game go on. But there's a second strike. And now Casey's not hitting around anymore. Look at that picture. Isn't that incredible? It's coming out of his ears.
For those of you who know, I am currently in what was formerly Miller Park, now American Family Field, because naming rights. That has to be, we'll have to have Casey at the naming rights or something like that. But I like the mustache they've painted on Casey, because we had a man named Raleigh Fingers who was a pitcher here in Milwaukee, and he was quite the superstar. And he had no the bones about it. Yeah, absolutely. Well oiled.
Did he have pain for his final picture of No Joy in Mudville? I swear, this picture is the most joyless illustration I have ever seen. It's just awesome. Am I right? There's even crows on the town side. It's dismally rainy. You've got the abandoned ball in the mud.
Wonderful. Oh my gosh. I think in cinema they use filters to get that effect. Well, that's great.
The wonderful thing about Casey at the Bat is that it encapsulates the fact that you never know what you're going to get, no matter how sure you are. Keep in mind, the narration of the poem has us sure of two things. One, we're sure is going to work in our favor, and one, we're sure is going to work against us, and we're wrong in both cases. Right. Flynn and Blake do not live down to their reputation. They actually surprise the crowd. And the reputation of Casey could not be higher. And he strikes out. Plain and simple. The way the game goes.
Baseball is wonderful in that you can always count on some form of heartbreak, in a game or a season.
The only real losers in the poem, I mean, when Casey calms down, I'm sure he will realize that people strike out. That's just the up and down of the game. The only real losers that were told early on in the poem, that when it looks like Flynn and Blake are next in line and that there's no chance Casey will get to bat, some people get up and leave. So let's make sure that we wrap up our book of the day today by stressing that the number one secular sin you can commit in American society is to leave your team before the last minute of the last inning.
With that in mind, I would like to remind people that I look at the stats on book of the day, and occasionally, not too many, but some of you depart before the video has ended.
So the mighty Casey has taken his final swing. Heresy.
So if you're still here as we wrap things up for the day and the week, good on you. And if you haven't,
you can't leave early. You never know what left turn this might take.
Absolutely.
Here at the end of this broadcast, I am willing to implicate Casey in the January 6th insurrection.
You got to stay for the credits. You have to stay for the credits.
For the credits. What's wrong?
Absolutely.
With
you? You know, well, I'm hoping Marvel will train people. There may be a post-credit sequence for all we know on today's broadcast.
Or are you implying that Book of the Day is going to become the new national pastime?
I thought that was the marketing program for 23, Steve. I've been to those meetings. So there we are. Things are good. Wonderful choice. Wonderful book. That edition, I'm going to see if it's in our library system.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's just great. 20 years old, but it's my favorite one. It's the one that I've kept of all the ones that I've seen.
Certainly. And really interesting.
Again, our kids book is once again a kids book that anybody of any age can love.
Sure, obviously. Absolutely. I mean,
there was a famous vaudeville performer who did this poem to packed crowds.
Yep.
Constantly. That was what he went for. If he took too long in his routine, people would just start calling it out from the crowd.
But they wouldn't leave early. Interesting.
Was a staple, much like Who's on First.
Yeah.
Was
yep.
one of the time a baseball related staple.
I believe Disney animated a version of this as well as a short cartoon. No, and they actually used the no alterations to the poem. They had it may have been someone like Sterling Holloway who was probably on Disney staff or on their, you know, so a great reading and wonderful animation to go with it. So I'm sure that's out there somewhere. But I would like to remind you, since we are at the credits, that Book of the Day is brought to you Monday through Friday as a service of the CPL Radio and made possible by the Friends of the Cedarburg Public Library in Cedarburg, Wisconsin. Heroes, all of them. He's Steve Dottie.
Mudville 9.
Perfect. He is Steve Dottie. I am Jeff Messerman. We will see you back here next week, and thank you for tuning in, everybody. Take care.
Bye, everybody.